Good evening. Welcome to the Portsmouth Zoning Board of Adjustment meeting for May 28, 2013. We are reconvening from our meeting from last week, May 21st, for the items we didn't finish. Tonight's agenda was scheduled to deal with cases 5-9 through 5-12, and also 5-1. We are in an unusual situation this evening. It's the first time I can recall where we only have five sit-in board members due to various conflicts with other board members. This does happen on occasion, but usually it's just with one petition during the course of the evening or something like that. It usually doesn't we're usually not in this position for a whole meeting. With that said, our protocol is that we give every applicant the option to request a postponement because you still need four votes to receive your variance request or special exception, even if there's only five sit-in board members. So all of the applicants that were scheduled for the agenda this evening, we did put out the word to everyone to let them know that they have the option to postpone if they would so like. We did get two positives on that request. So those two, we will make a motion. We'll ask for a motion to postpone those till next month. We'll vote on that. And then we have one request for a withdrawal, and then we have two petitions that we will hear this evening. So I am going to take things out of order just so we can deal with the postponements in case people are here from the public for one of these items that has been postponed. And I do apologize that you took time out of your day to come here and to hear this or to speak to this, and it has been postponed. We did try to get the word out there as best we could. I'll first note that petition 5-11 for 361 Islington Street, that has been withdrawn totally. If anyone's here for that, I will next move on to case 5-10, petition of 480 Dennett Street. The petition of Mark and Janet Greenwood for 40 Dennett Street, Assessor Plan 160, Lot 26, and the General Residence A. They were looking to add a second dwelling unit in an existing structure and replace a garage. This petition has been requested to postpone, and I will entertain a motion from the board.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. That request for postponement has been granted. Again, I will be going out of order here. The request of case 5-12. And this is the... We didn't even get a chance to read it, and they're out the door, but that's all right. I do apologize for that. Petition of Strawberry Bank, property located off of Washington Street, Assessor Plan 104, Lot 7. They were looking to construct an outdoor skating area and supporting structures. This has been requested to be postponed. I will entertain a motion.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
And third. Mr. Ring, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, the request for postponement has been granted. All right. Now we can get down to business. Move on to case 5-9, petition of JEDA, Revocable Trust, for Darrell McFadden, Jeffrey Poloni, trustees, for property located at 272 Newcastle Avenue, Assessor Plan 207, Lot 37. This is in the zoning district, single residence B. They're looking to replace an existing front porch with an enclosed 11-foot by 10-foot porch and a 10-foot by 8-foot deck, and also to construct a 4-foot by 10-foot rear deck. This will require a variance from Section 10.321 in Section 10.324 to allow a lawful non-conforming building to be expanded or reconstructed in a manner that is not in conformity with the zoning ordinance, and also a variance from Section 10.521 to to allow a right yard setback of 4.5 feet where 10 is required, a rear yard setback of 23.5 feet where 30 feet is required, and building coverage of 26.2% where 20% is the maximum allowed. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
Hi, I'm Darlene McFadden, 272 Newcastle. And I'd first like to state that I purchased the property from Jetta Trust in March, and I guess the visionaire hasn't been updated, so I am the sole owner of the property.
Okay.
And the two variances I'm looking for today, one is the backyard is a deck, which the house is a duplex. The original structure is an 1820 front entry colonial, and I've not been able to determine when the addition, which makes up most of unit 272, has been built. My best guess is early 1900s. I'm here today for 272, that unit. The back deck would allow a second exit point from the unit in case of fire, and that's the main issue, is to have a second access and mainly exit point for safety reasons. It would allow for easy access to the backyard for reasonable enjoyment of the property. Currently, to access the backyard, I have to exit via the front door and walk around the house. So if I want to go out in the backyard and grill, I'll take my dog out for necessities, and he's a pretty big dog, and or to enjoy the quiet away from the street traffic, I have to exit via the front and walk around to the back. The requested size of the deck, the reason for the variance mainly is there's a tree root, which I enclosed a picture of the tree root. And the unit was built around this tree root. And what's visible now is probably at 15 inches up from the ground, but the roots spread out probably about 3.5 feet. And I couldn't remove the tree root because it would compromise the foundation. Actually, there's another 10, probably 8 feet across of tree root under the addition that we found. Removal would really compromise the foundation since it continues under the structure so far. And I don't know if you'd like me to discuss the deck or to move on to the front porch.
You can move on to the front porch, and we'll ask you questions if you have any when you're done.
Okay. The front porch, what I'm asking for is variance to replace the current structure and with a three-season porch and a deck. The entry to 272 actually looks like a side entrance. It's not original to the 1820 part of the house. It was, I'm not even sure when it was built. I don't even know if it was built when the addition was added. But most visitors first go to the front door of 274. It's just the visible, it looks like the front door entrance. So my visitors, even though I tell them 272 and it's clearly marked with a on the mailbox, they usually go to 274 originally. And tradesmen go there and be able to replace that, move it over a little bit, and really differentiate it as a separate entrance from 274 would really help with to tradesmen, emergency personnel. It would also add to the aesthetic of the house. It would just look like, you know, it's a duplex, there's two separate units. And bring it back from the street, pushing it back, would add another parking place. Currently, to park a second car there, it parks in front of the steps. And if it's a large SUV or a truck, it really gets close and sometimes goes over into the street. And the other issue with the deck, putting a deck there, there are thousands of people walking along that street, walking, jogging, biking, segwaying, to look at the view across the street, to look at the water view over to Pierce Island. And it would be nice if I could also have that view on a deck. And then if they actually ever turn the other way, it'd be nice to have a attractive view for them to look at, right, you know. So there I am for any questions.
I just have one question. The photograph showing the, it looks like, is it a slide-in patio door?
Right, French door in the back.
So that's for the 4-foot by 8-foot?
Right. Four by 10.
Four by 10. Is that going to have railings or anything on it?
I think by code it has to, if it's so high. I mean, how they build it, it's, they actually...
It just doesn't look very high. I mean, the code's 30 inches that you need a railing?
I would rather not have a railing myself, actually. But it, I think it depends on the code. It slants down.
The only reason I'm asking, though, is I can't quite tell how much it slants. We had an applicant here last week for a small deck, slightly larger than this maybe, but it was less than 18 inches high, and you don't need a variance for that. So I was just trying to see, get a sense of how high this was.
Where the tree root is, I wouldn't need a variance, but to...
The other side, it looks like it's...
Right, but it just, was it, it slopes off towards the edge of the house. You know, and that's, I mean, the house hasn't been touched. The people who owned it previously bought it in the 60s, and so there's a whole lot of, you know, landscaping that could be done, and so it's, I mean, it's really kind of unfinished back there.
So we'll move ahead with the variances as requested, and we'll consider that rear deck as part of that. Are there any questions from the board? Ms. Russo?
Regarding the side yard setback, is your house already sort of 4.5?
It is 4.5, but between the house down the, right, from the fence.
Okay, so we're not really increasing anything that's already there on that particular one. We just have to deal with that because it's an existing condition. Both of them are existing.
In fact, the deck in the back, because it's offset, so it would be probably, I think, 3 feet in, so that would add another 3 feet to the edge of the back deck. Actually, you can see the board that when I had it sided, I had them place that board there, so it's...
Do you know what the rear yard setback is now versus what you're requesting? You're requesting 23.5 where 30 is required. Do you know what it is now, just so we can see the difference?
Well, it would be, the 23 was...
Because you're adding on to the back, right?
Four more.
Right, it would be four more.
About four more.
Right, yeah.
Okay. That's helpful.
Any further questions, Mr. Raymond?
Yes. I just want to understand a little bit better. So you currently own the property that's 272. 274, is that, are you in a condominium association?
No,
with those
properties? It's a duplex. I own the whole building.
Okay.
It's two units.
Okay.
It hasn't been condoed.
All right, so you own both units?
Right.
But you currently are residing in 272?
Correct.
Okay. And what portion of the original 1820s home does the 272 property incorporate? Does it incorporate portions of it?
The two front, did I give you a front picture of the house? The two front,
yeah.
Front rooms.
Okay.
On the first floor and the second floor actually is 272. So the 274 actually starts at the doorway.
Okay.
To the left side, and that's where it starts.
And incorporates, like, there's an addition on the back end of the house on that side as well?
It was originally an L house. Mm-hmm. So the front is just a classic center entry colonial, and then it L'd out. So it L'd the part, and the long part goes in the back. It goes out about 14 feet.
Okay. Thank you.
Any further questions from the board? Hearing none, thank you. Okay. Is there anyone to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone in the public to speak in opposition? 2-4 against. Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request for side setback, rear yard, and lot coverage. I will entertain a motion.
I'll move to accept it as presented.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Your motion, please.
Okay. There was no neighbors that have come in to protest the nonconformity, and it appears that it's a very slight incremental change. I mean, it's already a nonconforming building. Clearly, from the picture, it is falling apart.
Yes.
Needs, yes. To be fixed. And there is a reason that to create an entryway for a second duplex, I think, is a, makes it a reasonable request. I'll just go through the criteria. Would not be contrary to the public interest. It would improve the look of the building. It's not going to be a substantial change to what is there now. Granting the variance observes the spirit of the ordinance. The ordinance is to keep non-conforming buildings from further non-conformance. I think this is not going to change the essential character of this building, and therefore the essential character of the neighborhood. Granting the variance would do substantial justice for the same reasons. It would not diminish the values of surrounding property. It should improve it. The special conditions, I think it's significant that you have a tree root that is supporting the foundation and can't be removed. That makes it a little bit awkward to create the setbacks. And also, she's going to be creating another parking space, which I think is of value. So for these reasons, I believe it should be accepted.
Thank you. Your second, please.
I guess I would just add, this is a really a small infill project. There's no change to the sideline setback, and the change to the sideline to the rear setback is offset by the fact that it's a safety improvement with respect to access and egress from the right-hand unit. So I think that all in all, it meets all our criteria.
Thank you. Any further comment from the board, Mr. Raymond?
If I may, I will be supporting the motion. Just to explain a little further some of my thoughts on it. One of the more substantial aspects of this project, the sun porch area that's being created, really is within the allowable setback. So the most substantial portion that would affect potential, you know, light and air upon the neighbors is really already within the zoning requirements. It's primarily these two much less intrusive porches that are causing our problems here. In particular, also for the back setback of 30 feet, one of the unique hardships that's occurring with this property is the odd shape of the lot with a sort of a little chunk taken out of the corner of it. And the fact that, as the applicant has indicated, they're sort of forced to push the porch toward that direction by a pre-existing condition. So that's really sort of creating the situation that we find ourselves here that's requiring the rear setback variance, which I think appears to be a reasonable one. And then the fact that the neighboring property on that side of the house is the actual dwelling unit is quite some distance away, and then there's a garage that's between that and what's being proposed here for the front half of the building really adds further to what the applicant is asking for, and therefore I support it.
Thank you. Any further comment from the board? Hearing none, I will call for a vote, and the motion is to grant. Mr. Ayoub?
Yes.
Ms. Chamberlain?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Ms. Russo?
Yes.
And the chair votes yes. Has been granted.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Good luck with that.
Thanks.
Enjoy your view.
Thank you. Looking forward to it.
Moving on to case 5-1, the petition of T. Bayer Realty LLC owner, DAS Auto LLC applicant, for property located at 141 Banfield Road, unit number 1. Assessor Plan 254, Lot 2, in the Zoning District Industrial. Looking to open an automotive repair, restoration, and have state inspections. This will require a special exception under Section 10.440, Use Number 11.20, to allow the provision of automotive repair, restoration, and state inspections in the district where such uses are only allowed by special exception. And also a variance from Section 10.592, to allow a motor vehicle service station less than 200 feet from a residential or mixed residential district. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
How's it going?
Good. Just good. Introduce yourselves and walk us through the project.
Yeah, my name is Peter. This Scott, sorry. My name is Nick. This is Peter. I'm really nervous, by the way. Mary will tell you.
We're just your neighbors.
Yeah, I know. That's what she kept saying. Don't be nervous. That's a silly thing to be nervous
your
about.
Name.
I first want to apologize for last week. That is probably the most embarrassing moment in my adult life. when Kate, who works in the registry department, she's one of our customers, she's a super nice lady, she sent me an email to ask how the meeting went. And I said, I'm sorry, what meeting? She said the adjustment meeting was last night. And I said, oh, I think you're mistaken. She's like, no, it was definitely last night. This is Mary's number, you should probably give her a call. So I did, and I just want to apologize for that. I felt extremely foolish about that, so.
Some miscommunication.
Yeah, so that being said, basically, we are already in the unit. We already applied to get in there in the first place back in September, and we were accepted for detailing and light reconditioning of automobiles. And essentially, what we'd like to do is expand that to include state inspections. And to do so, that's why we had to file the special exception. I don't feel like it's going to be any detriment to the neighborhood or surrounding businesses, or I mean, there really isn't any houses.
No, we were surprised to find out that it's zoned as residential, so we're looking over in the woods.
Yeah, and Nick was as well. When Nick called me, because I handed in all the paperwork and everything was accepted, and then Nick called me after the fact and said, I apologize, but you have to fill out another piece of paper for a variance because it borders a residential. And I'm looking around and I'm like, where is this residence? But apparently the across the street from us is a mixed residential, which we didn't know. So that's why we had to file for that too. But as far as, you know, increased noise or traffic or pollution, I mean, we're an industrial building with a bunch of other, you know, similar kind of uses. So we don't feel as though it's going to be, you know, a detriment to the property or to the neighborhood.
So right now you have been granted permission to do the automotive detailing. And
correct. Yep.
So you're here, like you said, essentially just to add state inspections,
right,
to that.
Exactly.
To what your services you offer.
Yep.
Do we have any questions from the board? Ms. Chamberlain?
Thank you. I was looking at the history, and it says that Unit 7 was granted a special exception to allow motor vehicle service. Is that still in operation? Do you know?
No.
No.
So
I don't think so.
Yeah. Yep.
And will you be doing repairs and oil changes?
Light repairs.
Like that?
Yeah. I mean, we don't get into anything. We don't get into, like, motor swaps or anything that's too filthy. Like, we like to keep it pretty clean. I mean, the majority of the time we're working on, you know, older vehicles, things that are... for example, we just had a customer that purchased a 73 Ford Bronco, and it was kind of a project where the guy that he bought it from had built it, and it was about 80% done, but it needed little things, like electrically it needed things, like the gas gauge didn't work, and the horn didn't work, you know what I mean? Like, we kind of just buttoned it up for him, freshen up the suspension, stuff like that. We don't get into, like, motor swaps and stuff that's really filthy, kind of grungy work. We try to stay away from that. And we try to stay away from more restoration stuff for clients. And I guess that's the difference between, like, a customer and a client. For us, the client is more of, like, a long-term job, something that's, you know, a classic car that needs, you know, kind of a special touch that you're not just going to bring it to, you know, any place to get that done, so.
And will it change the amount of cars you have on the lot? Will it be more or less the same?
No.
Pretty much the same.
Yeah.
Really, it's just the having a state inspection sign.
Yeah.
Basically offering one more thing for our customers.
Exactly. So, because, yeah. I mean, essentially where we're at is right now we can do all of the work up until it needs to get inspected. And then we don't,
and then
right, and then we don't have an outlet for that. So it's, I don't know. It's an inconvenience for our customers, and it stinks to be able to do, like, a really great job on a restoration on like something old and something that we know we've just went through it, so we know that it's all set. But for them to have to pick it up and take it to someone else, the way that they write the laws are so vague as far as inspections are concerned. I mean, if you really wanted to find something to fail someone for a sticker, I'm sure you all know, you all get inspections. There are ways around it. They could potentially find something to fail you for. So that's the thing that's tricky for us, is to give the vehicle back to the customer and say, I mean, good luck, I guess.
Yeah, it's...
So we'd like to be, I guess, we'd like to be able to offer the same service and do, you know, a more complete job, something start to finish. So that way we can start it, we can make sure that everything is safety-wise is good to go, and then we can give the customer back the car with a sticker on it, and they don't have to, you know, there's no running around. They can leave and they can drive the car, and they're good to go until next time.
How many cars would you say you do a week?
there's a lot more long-term stuff. I mean, like four or five, like, yeah, kind of bigger projects, like the last car we had in the bay for, you know, probably 4 days. So, yeah, you know, we can't exactly squeeze too many other things in there. So,
yeah, there's definitely a lot of that going on. Plus, it's just me and Peter. It's just the two of us. So, I mean, we don't have a whole lot of time to be taking on. And, I mean, the way that we schedule work is we like to start a project and finish it. We try not to schedule a bunch of, you know, little things on top of that, just because it's not an efficient way to work.
So you're not like a Luster King where you're,
oh God,
cranking through, yeah, five no, cars a day.
Oh, no.
Okay. This is different. This is higher end detail.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Any other questions, Mr. Ray?
Not to disappoint. So your unit one appears to be the smallest unit of this entire complex. And how much room realistically in there do you have to work on? I mean, can you fit more than one vehicle in there? Or
we can fit like two or three comfortably.
Okay. Comfortably.
But, I mean, we like to take on, like you said, we like to, from start to finish, get one car done, make sure that is all set. And because a lot of stuff we do is not cut and dry. It's not your brick job on a Corolla by any means. A lot of European cars and classic cars, so
okay,
very straightforward.
But there's really only like one roll up door that you can get cars in and out through, so it's pretty restrictive as far as that goes. And a lift, do you intend to add a lift, or do you currently have a lift as part of this, or what's?
I mean, we would like to. It would make things easier, so that way we're not working on our back. There are some things that are just way easier when you can put a car at, you know, chest level and work on it. So
okay. But it would just be a single lift if you did.
Correct.
Most likely.
Yeah.
Okay.
Any other questions from the board?
I actually have one question, maybe. Just if we grant this, is the way that's written up, is unit one the only unit that is allowed the special exception and the variance if we grant this, or do we need to make that a stipulation?
I don't know the answer to that, but I would say that you could make that a stipulation.
Okay.
Either way.
All right.
In the past, it's always gone with the unit that's been advertised.
Right. Okay.
Any further questions or comments? No? Thank you. Seeing no one else here, I'll still go through the motions. Anyone here to speak in favor, in opposition, 2-4 against, seeing no one rise. I close the public hearing. We have a request for a special exception and a variance. I will entertain a motion. Someone can take on both of those, or we can take two votes. It might be easier to just do them all at once. Someone's up for that task.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Parrott.
I'll move approval of both the special exception and the variance together.
All right. Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
The special exception is, well, they're both pretty straightforward. The special exception is dealing with a use that's well established in that building. And as we all know, there isn't really any neighborhood concerns because of where the building is situated and the other work that goes on in the other units of the building. There have been fan conversion place work done, I know, in at least one of the other bays. So the automotive uses are very common to that. And it sounds like they're not going to be doing the high noise welding and carbon arcing and sandblasting and those other things that would be a little more disruptive, and we'd may have to take concern with respect to the other units. So having said that, I'm satisfied that it meets all the special exception requirements in terms of not creating problems for the other units in the building. Secondly, the variance is to allow, in addition to the services they already provide, and we have to deal with the five criteria there and just touch on them briefly. The variance will not be contrary to the public interest. It's hard to see that there's any public interest that is at risk here because of where the building is situated, as I say. And the spirit of the ordinance will be observed. That's essentially the same test these days because they kind of melded together. Again, there's no public interest, I think, that's of concern. Substantial justice will be done. The tip in this case, I think, is to the applicant versus the public concern, because they're not going to be doing anything that's going to be of annoyance or jeopardy to the general public. Fourthly, the values of surrounding properties will not be diminished. This is a commercial endeavor, almost industrial in nature, in a zone where that work has been going on for years and years without any apparent problems. And finally, literal enforcement of the provisions of the ordinance will result in an unnecessary hardship. In this case, just because of quirks of zoning, they have to come in for variance, but there is nothing that says that this property poses any difficulties that are unique, and therefore I think that their hardship is the way it, simply the way it's zoned, how it's zoned, I should say, with respect to what's going on there for historically for a long period of time, and the zoning is what it is, so they have to come in for a variance. So I think it meets the hardship test as well.
Thank you. Your second, please.
Yes, I concur with Mr. Parrott's comments. I'll just maybe elaborate a little bit on the special exception criteria. Standards as provided by this ordinance for the particular use are permitted by special exception. My review of the table in question shows that it is for the industrial area permitted use. No hazard to the public or adjacent property on account of potential fire explosion or release of toxic materials. I think the applicants have satisfactorily indicated to us that the types of work that they're doing there will not be adding anything significant in those areas. No detriment to property values in the vicinity. Again, as Mr. Parrott pointed out, this is a largely industrial area. Really nothing that's being done here that would negatively impact that. No creation of a traffic safety hazard or substantial increase in the level of traffic congestion, as the applicants have indicated. The overall amount of business that they expect to have will not increase. In general, this is an area that has good access to Banfield Road. No apparent signs of a traffic issue there. No excessive demand on municipal services, such as water, sewer, waste disposal, police and fire protection, and schools. Again, as the applicants have indicated with this industrial use, the buildings already has a certain capacity. There's nothing that they're really doing that would appear to increase upon that. No significant increase in stormwater runoff to adjacent property. Again, there's no new construction here or anything that's being done that would affect that. So therefore, I second the motion and recommend approval.
Thank you. Any further comment from the board? Just before I call for a vote and close this, could I just have you each state your first and last name into the microphone, just so Mary has it for the record?
Sorry. Nicholas Cormier.
Okay.
Peter Bork.
All right. Thank you, guys. All right, we have a motion to grant. I will call for a vote. Mr. Raum?
Yes.
Ms. Chamberlain?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Ms. Russo?
Yes.
The chair votes yes. The petition has been granted.
That's the only thing to be heard. You guys are all wonderful. Thank you so much.
Good luck with that.
Yes. Not everyone concurs with your sentiment. We appreciate it.
I'm sure. Those are just bad apples, though. That's not that fair. Mary, thank you so much.
I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned.